Amen. Well, welcome everyone. Yes, you can clap, you can applaud. Palm Sunday, beginning of Holy Week. Welcome. I'm so glad to see so many people here. We do have to be mindful of our COVID protocols, though. Let's just, be careful how we gather afterwards. And, I don't like, if you've worshiped with me long enough, I don't like rules. But these are rules we have to adhere to for at least the coming future. And I think I speak for everyone here. We're all getting tired of those rules. Amen? Amen. All right. I have two announcements, actually, and I believe Bobby wants to share something. Tomorrow, a big event's happening. We're actually receiving a Yamaha Baby Grand Piano as a gift. Yeah, it's like immaculate shape. Paolo was able to make a connection with somebody in the community who actually I had known the individual who owned it. He was my eighth grade teacher. Richard Sullivan, and Richard passed in about eight years ago now. But we want to put the piano over here and actually relocate the organ over here. So if I can have after worship a couple of strong people, I didn't just say men, strong people who could help move this and slide it into position. And those are my announcements, Bobby. Mike.
Mike's on. Yeah. My nose, though. Hello? Patty wanted to paint this red, so I'd look like Rudolph, but I told her no. So for Easter flowers, since we came in late in the game, we're just going to, anything that you would like to bring and then take home after Easter, if you could show up next Saturday, I'll be here at 10. If you can't be here at 10, you can drop them off because some people have said they can't make that time. And sometime before Easter Sunday, I will have them arranged here on the altar. So that's our Easter flower situation this year. So any questions, you can see me later. Thanks.
So if I call my singers forward, we'll begin with the opening hymn, All Glory, Lord, and Honor. And stand if you're comfortable. You can sway. You can hum. Just don't sing out loud so I don't have to give that rule.
Children children, make sweet Hosanna spring. The distant accept their praises, accept the prayers we bring. Who we all good delightest, thou good and gracious King.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you for all that you have blessed us with, Lord. And we just ask that now everything that we return to you would show the adoration for the love that we have in our hearts for you. May everything bring glory to you that we sing, say, and do in this moment, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A call to worship. You follow along with me. Almighty God, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross. Grant that we may share in his obedience to your will and his glorious victory of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna.
Hosanna, you are the God
Lord, we do welcome you here. We welcome you into our lives, Lord, and we thank you, Lord, that you do respond, that you did come to us, Lord, when we cried out in the depths of our pain, and Lord, that you've come to us now to receive the love that you so richly deserve. We thank you, Lord, that you didn't withhold one thing from us, that you gave us the opportunity to not only know our salvation, but to know your love first, and then your salvation that comes from your great mercy. We thank you, Lord, that we know that even if we've made a mistake this week and we've sinned against your will, we've turned against the needy, we've endured another senseless tragedy in this country of ours, Lord, help us to be empowered to bring the change you so desperately want. Help us to shed ourselves of our inhibitions and our fears, Lord God, so that we can walk as your disciples in this time and place. We thank you, Lord, that even when we have turned against you, Lord, that you still forgive us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we can declare that we are forgiven in your name. Glory to God. Amen. And Lord, we thank you that you gave us a prayer to remember how we're to conduct ourselves in this world when you taught your disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
Is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my bed. The scripture reading for this Palm Sunday, it comes from Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. It's Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples ahead, saying to them, Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them both and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, The Lord has need of them, and he will send them immediately. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet, saying, Tell the daughter of Zion, Look, your king is coming to you, humble, and mounted on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of the donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks upon them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd had gathered now, and they spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the palm trees and trees around and spread those upon the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed him all shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest! When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, Who is this? Who is this? The crowds were saying, This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Ride on, King Jesus. No one can hinder thee. Ride on, no one can hinder thee.
King Jesus rides to Jerusalem,
no one can hinder thee.
Hosanna to King David's son,
no one can hinder thee.
He rides upon a donkey small,
no one can hinder thee.
the King of peace, the Lord of all.
No one can hinder thee.
Ride on, King Jesus. No one can hinder thee. Ride on, King Jesus. Ride on, no one can hinder thee. The children sing and they dance and shout.
No one can hinder thee.
If they won't praise, the rocks cry out.
No one can hinder thee.
King Jesus done just what he said.
No one can hinder thee.
He healed the sick and he raised the dead.
No one can hinder thee.
Ride on, King Jesus.
No one can hinder thee.
Ride on, King Jesus.
Ride on, no one can hinder thee.
The light of God shines on his face.
No one can hinder thee.
He offers all his pardoning grace.
No one can hinder thee.
Come join the throng, your voices raise.
No one can hinder thee.
The King of love deserves your praise.
No one can hinder thee.
Ride on, King Jesus.
No one can hinder thee.
Ride on, King Jesus.
Ride on, no one can hinder thee.
Ride on, King Jesus.
No one can hinder thee.
Ride on, King Jesus.
Ride on, no one can hinder thee.
No one can hinder thee. No one can hinder thee.
Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, as we are entering Holy Week, we give thanks for all Jesus, our Christ, has given to us at a great expense. He sacrificed his life for our eternal life. He gave far more than any of us could ever give. We praise his gift and accept it with God's terms. We pray that the words that Pastor Tom passes through our ears into our hearts and souls can help us to create a lifestyle that will please our Father. From God's thoughts to our pastor's lips, may we all receive God's word today and always. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Debbie. By the way, that's 3 years of music lessons. Yeah, we also do bar mitzvahs and weddings, and we're willing to. It's good to have a little laughter in this world. Amen? Amen. Well, it's Palm Sunday, and every year we go through the machinations on the way to Holy Week, and actually Jesus now in our story is arriving into the city, the Roman-occupied city of Jerusalem for the Passover. He's coming there intentionally for that. Now, at this point in time, Jesus' popularity has reached an all-time height. People are going out of their way to show their love and affection for him. They basically have stripped the entire countryside of all branches. They've thrown their cloaks on the road in order to smooth out his way into Jerusalem. Now, as far as his earthly ministry is concerned, Jesus will never be afforded a greater show of affection than he is right now. The crowd are loving him at this moment. Doesn't seem to be anything they won't do for him. In fact, they can even go and borrow a donkey from somebody inside just saying Jesus wants it. This is the kind of adoration he's following, he's coming in on. But the next five verses that we didn't read, that follow immediately after this in Matthew's gospel, it's evident that not every single person in Jerusalem has those same exact feelings. Well, because once he dismounts and enters into the table and turns the money changers' tables over, and then on the way out he heals a bunch of people, well, actually, the scriptures say the teachers of the law see all this and they're indignant, indignant. On top of everything Jesus is doing, they now want to complain to him that they have to listen to children waving palm branches and shouting, "Hosanna in highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." You know, it's like Jesus responds in a piece in that moment by actually quoting Psalm 8, verses 2, when he says, "From the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise," which is his way of saying, lighten up. Just be in the moment. There's something good is transpiring. And then in verse 17, Jesus says, after all of that, if you read on ahead, he goes to Bethany for the evening. But I ask myself, why not stay in Jerusalem? I mean, after all, there's got to be a place for him now with his popularity, unlike when he was born and no place for him in Bethlehem. But it's got to be a place he can stay in Jerusalem. You know, I always wondered about that, and then I did a little bit more study and I got into it, and the theory is, actually it comes from a theory that I had heard another pastor offer in a sermon about 15 years ago. The pastor used an analogy in that sermon of hallways in a hospital. I know I just transitioned on you, so I want to make sure you capture that. Hallways in a hospital, for those who know or are familiar with hospitals, you know that the hallways connect rooms where everyday life happens. You know, in the hallways, there can be, the hallways are connected to room where life and death events take place. For example, there could be in one room, people are celebrating the birth of a new baby, or it could be a recovery of a person who had been seriously injured or seriously ill is now feeling better. It's a room of celebration in that room. But just down the hall, in another room, people could be experiencing grief, either an impending loss or the actual loss of a loved one. See, that makes the hallway kind of a pathway in life that both connects the rooms as well as it separates these rooms of celebration and loss. Rooms that we all travel to during our lifetime. Amen? Life being what it is, you know that, right? You see, but the thing is, the majority of our lives, though, you know, we live actually in the reality of the hallways. But they're shaped, nonetheless, by the events that transpire in the rooms of celebration and the rooms of loss. And life being what it is, you know you could be headed to either room in a heartbeat. Maybe just think about that for a minute. You know, memories, the memories that we get from those particular rooms, they shape our perceptions and they can help us determine actually the tract of our lives and the way we handle life as we navigate through the hallways of life. Because you see, what happens in those rooms can have an effect on the way we perceive the lives that we live. And it can have a long-lasting effect, meaning that for those who are frequent visitors to the room of grief, well, you tend to see life maybe on more negative terms, just about experiencing loss. Consequently, if you're one of those individuals who never have really gone to any place but this room of celebration, well, you know you tend to live your life on more positive terms. You know, as I said last week, though, church, it is so good to invite Jesus into our celebrations and not just our tragedies. That's an important part of everything that we go on, because if we don't invite him into our celebrations, we feel like we've never had one. The thinking is that, church, you know, our good past as well as our bad always show up in our future. They always do, no matter how you think about it. So it's a big mistake to ever think memory-wise that the past is the past. So what does that have to do, you may be asking yourself this morning, with Jesus arriving into Jerusalem, actually leaving Jerusalem to spend the night in Bethany? I'm glad you asked. Just so you know, there are a few conflicting accounts in the Bible as to what is actually happening in Bethany on this particular occasion. But in Matthew's account, Jesus goes and he visits the house of Simon the leper, where in the middle of a celebration, he's anointed by this unnamed woman with perfume. This extravagant gesture of love actually doesn't sit well with the disciples. They see it as a waste of money. Could have been given to the poor. But Jesus tells them to stop bothering her and instead be in the moment of celebration because he is with them right now. Now, in the Gospel of John, Jesus actually goes to the home of Mary and Martha and Lazarus, the purpose of which was to celebrate Lazarus's return to life. You talk about walking across the hallway of grief one day and the resurrection of life the next. I mean, one minute Lazarus' family is grieving and the next minute they're rejoicing, and now Jesus is the guest of honor. And in the midst of this wonderful celebration, Mary anoints Jesus with a perfume. See, that extravagant gift, that gesture, was all because of her gratitude for bringing her brother Lazarus back to life. Now, after reading these accounts, it struck me that Jesus knows what lies ahead. He knows why he is there. Because he knows in a very short time, he's going to be, you know, instead of, making out his will or planning his funeral, he's not doing that. Even though he's keenly aware that soon he'll walk down the hallway to his own room of suffering and death. But now, right now, in the moment he's in, there's no such thing like that going on. It couldn't be better right now. There's no time, as far as he's concerned in the scripture, to celebrate than right now. Because his friend Lazarus is back, and they are all celebrating like there is no tomorrow. But not everyone is caught up in that celebration and that scene. Nope. Guess who's busy in the kitchen? Martha. We love Martha, don't we? We know if Martha's didn't belong to the church, nothing would get done. Amen? But Martha's in the kitchen. Good old Martha, the one who complained to Jesus that her sister Mary wasn't helping in another scene. And all I can say is, just like I said, is thank God for Martha's. But there is a warning, though, because Martha's can be so busy preparing for life in the hallway that they never enter into the celebration in the room. It's like sometimes they can miss that celebrating, and so they never really do. It's like too much of a good thing is just not a good thing. But Martha here is not the only person who's not in party mode. If you read on in John's gospel, you realize that just like the other disciples in Matthew's gospel, in John's gospel, Judas Iscariot criticizes Mary's act of anointing Jesus as a waste of money that could have been helped to use the poor. And the writer of John indicates actually that John wasn't really concerned about the poor. He was more concerned about getting his hands on the money. Regardless, it's certainty that Judas was not in that room celebrating, was he? No. Now Judas, much like the other disciples, he didn't really understand Jesus' ministry even at this point. So let's be fair with Judas. It's possible that his whole motivation for joining with Jesus was possibly to overthrow by force the Roman government that had been occupying Israel for so long and had brought suffering to his life. It's probably he endured a lot of suffering. But you see, I just get the feeling when I read about this that Judas would rather have led an insurrection than have Jesus lay his life down without a fight. Now, the only one who really knows Judas's mindset beside himself is Jesus. So Jesus tells him that the perfume was meant for his burial. And what Jesus was trying to convey to Judas was similar to what he told the religious leaders. You need to lighten up. because I'm with you now. I'm here, so let's have a party. Let's celebrate. You know, and soon Jesus knew he was going to be walking across that hall into that room of grief. And the truth is, church, has anything ever been wasted that's been lavished on Jesus? No. No. Plus, if you would ever ask anyone during a time of either celebration or grief how important money was, you know what they would say? It means very little. Money means very little in those celebrations. Amen? So this leaving for Bethany is all about allowing yourself to let go of the grief of the world for Jesus every once in a while and just to celebrate being in the presence of Jesus Christ. Just let go. And truthfully, the way the world is, as I said earlier in the prayer with another senseless shooting, it can be hard not to be in the room of grief. But I just thank God that no matter what room I'm in, Jesus is with me. And he's with you too. I get such a sense of urgency when I read this particular passionate scripture. I want to be with Jesus. I want to tell him how much he means to me. I want to express in my heart how much he's given me and for the new life that I've been given. And the way he's always been there for me, even when I didn't know it and then when I needed to know it. See, that makes gratitude, church, a very essential part or component of your faith. And I pray that no matter what room I ever enter, I never lose my sense of gratitude for what Jesus did for me and for us all on that cross on Good Friday. See, over the years, I've been told by many people they wish to have more of Jesus' presence in their lives. It's a common goal for many people. But see, if that is on your heart, if that truly is on your heart, you want more of Jesus in your life, well, what direction do you want to ask yourself? Are you heading in the hallway? Are you leaving a room of grief or entering it? Are you leaving the room of celebration or are you entering it? Because if you've experienced, as I said, a great deal of pain and loss, then you might be headed down the hallway of grief and not even know it. The idea then would be to try to find a way to the room of celebration right now. That's what we do every week. Every Sunday we do that intentionally. We come to church to lavish praise on the Savior of the world who did everything for us to make this possible, this life possible. And then we do that every Sunday because we want to walk down that hallway knowing that when we leave here, we at least appreciate that Jesus has never left us or forsaken us. See, living like that then brings Jesus into every moment we're in, and it brings joy to that understanding. I told this story a couple of years ago, actually 5 years ago. For those who don't know, I was in campus ministry at Suffolk Community College waiting to be appointed back in 99, sorry. And I met a bunch of diverse people over there at Suffolk Community College in Riverhead. It's a commuting college, and most of the kids come from kind of a, you know, middle class, lower middle class background. Well, there was this one student whose name was Anetta. Now, I want to give you a little background. She came from the Ukraine with her mother at the age of 18 and could barely speak English. They had lived in the shadow of Chernobyl. Her father had died of cancer the previous year. During the first 2 years that I knew Anetta, she and her mom moved no less than 7 times. Even with all that disruption, Anetta learning English and working part-time, she maintained a 4.0 average. Wow. I read the dean's list and I said to her, you celebrated, didn't you? You celebrated this event. And she replied to me, no, I have so much work to do. I can't. I don't have any time to celebrate. I have no time. And then, within a year, Anetta developed this really bad cough, and it wouldn't go away. And I didn't see her for the next semester. Well, I found out eventually she did go to a doctor, and she was diagnosed with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. She had a tumor the size of a softball in her chest cavity. I got a call from her mother, who reached out to me to have the college pray for Annetta. Church, her cancer was absolutely awful and terribly aggressive. She had to receive these massive doses of chemotherapy in the hospital. She couldn't get the chemo anywhere else but the hospital because of the illnesses that would come afterwards. All her hair fell out. So over the next 6 weeks or so, Bobby and I would occasionally go up to the hospital to see her and to encourage her and to pray for her. I posted her name on the lamp of my desk so that I could be in constant reminder to pray for her because, church, the odds were against her. And I remember thinking, this poor girl, man, she has overcome so much in this world, man. It would be a real miracle if she survived. And kind of lost contact after she, I guess, discharged. And then out of the blue, 3 months later, in another semester, I get a call from her mother. Actually, I get a call from Annetta. And man, she sounded great. She sounded great. And she told me, Pastor, the worst of it's over. Her recent tests came back and they were negative. And she said she and her mother now have so much gratitude. They didn't want to wait for one more test. They didn't want to wait for one more month. They wanted to be in the room celebrating her new life right then and right there. So they threw this big party for the campus to celebrate her return to health. What a great celebration that was. She no longer wanted to be in the room of grief. She wanted to be in the room of celebration. And I was so glad to be there with her. Amen. You see, this Lenten season is such a great time of introspection. This is where we really can look at ourselves and take a moment to see what direction our lives are really heading. Which way down the hallway of life are we traveling? And church, with a grateful heart, may you always be entering into the room of celebration with the Savior of the world, because that is the best and the healthiest way to live out your life and your faith. Someone want to say amen to that? Yeah. I'm acutely aware that Good Friday is in 6 days. I am. And there is good reason to stop and to remember how much the Savior suffered for us. But don't you ever forget that Sunday's celebration is coming. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, in all the things you give us the opportunity to celebrate the victories in our lives. Help us not to hold back for one moment, Lord God, to just raise you up and to let people know that you are the miracle that came into our lives and gave us this opportunity to know our faith. We thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. May our words always bring hope to those who need it. And Lord, we ask for the encouragement for those who may be in a room of grief right now. Allow them to know that it's totally okay, that you understand their grief. And help us, Lord God, to be compassionate to those who are grieving and give them the opportunity to come through and to celebrate once again. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. The offering is the trays are in the hallway because of, the protocol. So just to let you know, God loves a cheerful giver, and so does the pastor.
Okay, let me get this out of the way. I didn't steal that donkey, okay? I borrowed it. And it wasn't even my idea. Jesus told me to take it, to borrow it, right? Okay, this is how it happened. Earlier today, there was a large group of us, and we were traveling from Bethany to Jerusalem. We stopped just outside the city, and Jesus looked at two of us, and he said there was an unridden donkey just inside the village and asked us to go get it. He said, if anybody, asked us about it, we could just look at him and say, the Lord needs it and he'll send it back. So the two of us beat it into town. And the whole time we were like, what is Jesus going to do with a donkey, right? But By this point, we realized you don't second-guess Jesus, right? He hadn't told us why, and we didn't ask. We just got him a donkey. And when we got back, that's when it happened. Some people put their coats on the donkey, and Jesus got on the donkey. And when he got on the donkey, I don't know. It's like everyone started shouting and dancing and singing, and some people were throwing their coats in front of the donkey. There was some of us that grabbed some palm branches and we started waving them in the air. And that's when it clicked. Jesus had finally arrived. I know that sounds weird. It's like this. In the past, we would get excited because Jesus would do something, a miracle, or there would be some parable or something he said. We'd get excited about it. And Jesus would always be like, shh, come on, guys. No, nope. Just be quiet, you know? And then we'd come up with some idea. Hey, let's do this or let's do that. And Jesus would be like, no, guys, not now. Not now. But today? Today was now. Today, he finally let us shout and sing and dance and treat him like the Messiah that we'd all been waiting for. Finally showed up. I don't know. I don't know what tomorrow holds. It feels like it's something big, but who knows, you know? But it doesn't matter what happens because Jesus showed up. And there's nothing better than when Jesus shows up.
And God bless you all. Let's close our worship with Hosanna, loud Hosanna. And make sure you grab a palm on the way out if you didn't bring one in.
Children sang their praise.
And now may the Lord Jesus Christ grant you peace and mercy for the rest of the week. Lord, we ask that you would help us bring your celebration to this world, acknowledging the losses, Lord God, at the same time helping us to walk where angels fear to tread. We ask that you would bless us indeed as we go forth. In the name of the Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.